Welcome to Electra Online. In this video, we're going to start talking about what we call the source-free RCL circuit. RCL, of course, stands for resistor, capacitor, inductor. Source-free means that there's no voltage source or no current source. You may ask the question then, well, why would there be any current? The answer is because we start with some initial condition where there's some energy storage on the capacitor and or the inductor. Potentially both, depending upon the initial conditions, and it's that initial energy that causes current to flow through the circuit. The purpose essentially will be to come up with a second order differential equation, which we have here on the board. Of course, we're going to have to manipulate that equation so we can find the solutions to the equation, and after all, that's the purpose of understanding the RCL circuit, is to have a solution to that, second order differential equation. Well, in order to do that, we need to understand where this equation came from. So we get to that in just a moment. But first, let's look at what causes energy storage in either the capacitor or the inductor. Well, for the capacitor, the amount of energy stored depends upon the amount of charge on the capacitor. Essentially, the equation is that the energy equals 1/2 Q squared divided by the capacitance, Q, of course, for the charge. For the inductor, that is 1/2 Li squared, L being the inductance, and I being the current through the inductor. So you can see that the maximum energy in the inductor occurs when I is the largest. The maximum energy in the capacitor is when the charge is the largest. Well, it turns out when the current is the largest, when we reach maximum current in the circuit, we'll have maximum energy storage in the inductor, but zero energy stored in the capacitor. When we have maximum current to the circuit, there will be no charge on the capacitor. And vice versa, if we have maximum charge on the capacitor, then at that moment we will have zero current, so all the energy will be in the capacitor and zero energy will be in the inductor. So when we have maximum energy in the inductor, there's zero energy in the capacitor. When we have maximum energy in the capacitor, there is zero energy in the inductor. And of course, most of the time, that only happens at very specific moments in the current motion, but any other time of the circuit, there'll be some energy in both of the devices. The resistor, of course, will take energy out of the system. It will dissipate energy over time, and the current will diminish over time because of the resistor being there. Now, the polarity of the voltage across each component does depend upon what is happening in the circuit. The polarity of the resistor depends on the direction of the current. The polarity of the voltage across the capacitor depends upon the charge on the capacitor. And remember, you can have positive charge on one side, negative charge here, or we can have positive charge on this side and negative charge there. So the voltage orientation of the voltage across the capacitor will change its polarity depending upon how the charge is stored on the capacitor. And finally, the polarity of the voltage across the inductor depends on the rate of change of the current. Not on the current, but the rate of change on the current, and that's why you see a dIdt in the equation, in the second order differential equation. Now, if we're going to use the Kirchhoff's voltage loop, or if we go around the loop and we add up all the voltages, or add up all the voltage drops across the circuit, notice we have a voltage drop across a resistor, a voltage drop across the inductor, a voltage drop across the capacitor. When we add all the voltage drops, we get zero. Well, that would imply that when you have a drop across one of the devices, you'll have a voltage rise across at least one of the other components. Otherwise, they can't all be negative and end up being zero. So what happens is the polarity across the devices will always ping-pong back and forth depending upon what is happening in the circuit, such that when you add up all the voltages at any moment in time on the circuit, the sum will always add up to zero as you go around the loop. So if we then say that the voltage drop across the resistor, that must be the product of the current times the resistance. The voltage drop across the inductor will be the inductance times the rate of change of the current with respect to time. And the voltage drop across the capacitor will be the charge on the capacitor divided by the capacitance. Again, the polarity will depend upon what exactly is happening in the circuit, and we'll look at that in more detail in the upcoming videos. Instead of writing minus Q over C, because Q will be a function of time, but then here we have current, and there we have charge, it's better that every component or every term inside the equation is a function of current. So q can be replaced by the integral from 0 to t of I dt. In other words, this integral here computes how much charge has been placed on the capacitor from 0 to t. So this actually replaces q. Now we can see that we have three terms in the equation. Every one of the terms is a function or has a function of the current in it. And it doesn't matter if you make them all negative or if you make them all positive. Essentially, all you have to do is multiply both sides by negative 1, and you end up with this equation. So those two equations are exactly the same. Now, this is not yet in the proper form. The reason is because we should have a second order differential equation. So essentially what we're going to do is we're going to take the derivative with respect to time for all three of these terms to give it a proper format, and we'll do that in the videos coming up. Also, we're going to explore in more detail what happens across the resistor, what happens across the inductor, and what happens across the capacitor throughout the variation of the current through the circuit to understand how this equation actually makes sense. So that's all coming up. We'll go through it step by step. And after a few more videos, we'll know how to solve this equation and find the solutions to the second order differential equation for the source-free RCL circuit. That's the goal for what we're trying to do here.